morning, everybody. Just stand to your feet. We'll begin with some singing together.
He's coming on the clouds. Kings and kingdoms will bow down. And every chain will break. His broken hearts declare. Stop the Lord Almighty. Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. Every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains. Every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before Him. So open up the gates, make way before the King of Kings. Comes to save, he's here to set the captives free. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. Every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb. For the sins of the world, His blood breaks the chains. Every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Yes, every knee will bow before Him. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Stop the Lord Almighty. Who can stop the Lord? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. Every knee will bow before Him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains. Every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before Him.
Amen. Good morning, church. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Josh, and I have the privilege of being the children's pastor here at our Oakmont campus. And if you are new to Riverside, then I would like to say welcome to church. We are glad that you are here. And if you are new, you can take a look in the seat back in front of you. And if you're sitting in the front row, you can look in the seat back behind you and find an information card that you can fill out and give to us so that we can stay in touch with you. And if you have not yet downloaded our Church Center app, we please ask you to do that, because that will be an efficient and easy way for you to stay up to date with all that we have going on at Riverside. And speaking of things that we've got going on, next Sunday is one of my favorite Sundays ever, because it's Baptism Sunday. And we are going to be baptizing, I think it's up to 10 people now. So we've got 4 people. Yeah, you go ahead and clap for that. We've got 4 people here at our Oakmont campus and 6 people at our Mills campus, and there's still a week to go. So we could end up with like 50. Wouldn't that be incredible? 50 people baptized, that would be awesome. So we are so excited for that coming up. Cannot wait to celebrate those people making that decision in front of all of you. It's going to be a great Sunday. Please come. Bring friends if you want to so they can see what's happening. Baptism Sundays are like the best. Like they are up here. Like we're usually up here, but then they, boom, they just blasted out of the roof. It is incredible. I love it. I love it. I love it. So we are going to sing another song of worship, and then Pastor Jay is going to take us through the word this morning, and then we will have some more worship before I come back up and close it out with some celebratory announcements. So let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you so much for who you are and for all that you are doing in our lives. I pray that you would help us to continue to follow you, Lord. For anyone who has not found you, God, I pray that they would find you and they would follow you with everything that they have to give, God. And for those who have found you and are following you, I pray that even when we get tripped up, that we would get right back up and continue running after you, because you are running after us. We thank you so much for your love, for your dedication, and your mercy, Lord. And we pray these things in your precious name. And everybody said, amen. Let's worship. Sin anymore. And
feel the ground shake beneath us as the prison walls cave in. Nothing stands between us. Nothing stands between us. There is another in the fire standing next to me. There is another in the waters holding back the seas. And should I ever need reminding what power set me free, there is a grave that holds nobody, and now the power lives in me. There is another in the fire. There is another in the fire.
Let's bow our heads and pray. Lord Jesus, you have proven in the diciest of moments, in the hardest of times, in the most complicated situations, Lord, that you are always there. And not only there, God, but that you are actively solving those problems, God, dealing with the issues at hand, God. There's always another in the fire. There's always another crossing the water with us, God, making the way for us. We pray, Lord, that as we look towards the future, trusting you, believing, God, that you have even better things ahead, Lord, I pray this morning that you would give us unity, God, that you would give us repentance from any kind of divisiveness in our own hearts, that you would allow us, Lord, to be unified in a situation, in any situation, God, that you will face with us. We love you, Lord Jesus. We pray your power over these situations, God, and I pray your peace and your security and your unity over all of us, Lord. It's in your powerful name that we pray. Amen and amen.
Amen. Good morning, church. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Mike Wolf. I'm the missions and outreach pastor here at Riverside. Today we have a very special guest, Kim Costanza, the father of our student ministry pastor, Sam Costanza. And man, I tell you what an amazing family. But Kim is here to talk to you today about our Dominican Republic trip in February. He is the founder of Del Rey Ministries and makes 3 to 4 trips over there a year, supporting pastors and raising churches. So just an outstanding ministry, very, very effective, and just doesn't get any better than that. So with that, I'll turn it over to Kim.
Thanks. Good morning. I need to tell you how thrilled I am to be here, and especially to see Samuel serving. You don't know this, but he's one of 7 children, and when he was growing up, he was so bad that we thought he was going to be the one in prison. And so I thank you for keeping him out of prison. And Just a word of encouragement for you parents. All things are possible. All things are possible. So I do serve as the director of Del Rey Ministries, and I want to invite you to join Sam and I on a short-term mission trip to the Dominican Republic this February, 15 to 22. Now, I know it's a great sacrifice to leave Pittsburgh in February and go to a place that's full of palm trees and sunny and 85. I know it's a sacrifice, but I just want you to prayerfully consider it. Seriously, where in the world is the DR? Where is the Dominican Republic? We got a slide up there. I never knew where it was when I went on my first trip in 2007. It's an island somewhere between Florida and South America. It shares that island of Hispaniola with Haiti. And we'll be going there. And where do we work? We work, if you go to the next slide, in Central Dominican Republic in the sugarcane fields. Sugarcane is one of the main products of the Dominican Republic. And in those sugarcane fields are these tiny little villages of people with no hope, no dream, no vision. What's it like in a sugarcane field? If you go, this is a sugarcane worker. He gets up in the morning, wears a pair of rubber garden boots, no socks, goes out and cuts sugarcane by hand in the heat of the sun, and comes back, walks home, and lives there. If you haven't been on a third world country, how many have not been to a third world country? That alone is life-changing. That alone is life-changing. So that's where we'll be working. We'll be ministering to those people in the sugarcane fields. Now, where do we stay? We don't stay in that place. This is called Meeting God in Missions. It's a facility there that's very clean, very nice. It houses up to 150 people. And we'll stay in that, although that's about 30 minutes from the villages that we'll go to. And people always ask, well, what's the food like? And I wondered, like, do I have to take my jar of peanut butter or, you know, what will I eat? So that's the dining hall. Everybody there loves the food. The cooks have been there for 25 years. The food's delicious. Everything's safe and healthy. So we'll stay in a very safe, healthy place, and we'll go to the most incredibly difficult places just 30 minutes away. What will we do? Number of different ministries, and we'll just be led by the Spirit, quite honestly, in how we can serve these folks. But we'll do light construction. We're building a house for one of our missionaries. We hope we'll have a commissioning service for that. We'll do some painting and some repairs, maybe for some widows' homes. We'll also do some garden ministry. We teach some of the villagers how to plant gardens and have some food for their own homes. We'll do VBS. I know Sam and some of the others will lead some youth teams, some sports teams, some VBS. We'll also do some prayer ministries where we just go door to door, and you'll have a chance to sit in the home of one of these people and just hear their story and lay your hands on them, pray for them. It's an incredible ministry. We built two clinics down there, and we have two Haitian doctors that run those clinics, and I know we have at least one, maybe two nurses from here coming. We'll do some medical ministry, and you don't have to be a medical professional to be a part of that. There's a lot of needs for organizing people and taking numbers and getting people in line and praying with people. And so who are we serving? This last slide. These are the pastors that we support. Del Rey supports them and trains them. And so this is not a one-shot or a hit-and-run kind of mission. We're invested in the long term of these villages. So we have 20 pastors that we support, and we work in over 50 villages. So you'll be in a continuum if you go there. You'll be a part of if I could say, you're fresh troops on the ground to come and help these folks who are preaching the gospel and making disciples. I just want to take 1 minute, four quick reasons why you might go. The first is your own heart. Your own heart. The organization is called Meeting God in Missions, and the reality is a fresh encounter with God is what changes our lives. Can I get an amen if you're awake? A fresh encounter of God. Out of the abundance and the overflow of an experience with God, life changes. And I've been on more than 50 trips. I've been with thousands of people who have gone on this trip. I don't know anybody who came back and said, it was okay. That doesn't happen. Life changes. And so for your own heart, I'd encourage you to prayerfully consider going. The second is that your lens will be corrected to some extent on the kingdom of God. You know, truthfully, our lens of the kingdom of God sometimes is Oakmont or our little circle. And when you step out of that and see the world, you say, wow, I didn't see that before. This kingdom of God, and especially your brothers and sisters in places like the DR, it changes your view. The third one is you will impact and touch somebody with the love of Christ. I promise you that. I don't know how. I don't know the person. I don't know what you'll do. But you will have an impact on someone in the name of Jesus. And the last thing is you will help Riverside get a vision for what God has called you to in the Dominican Republic. You'll be the eyes and ears that experience and see something that only the Holy Spirit knows. I don't know, but the Holy Spirit knows that there's a reason Riverside has gotten involved in this ministry, and you're going to be a part of discovering that. So prayerfully consider going. I'd love to be with you. We'll have great morning devotions, great worship, and we'll have a lot of fun as well. Thanks for having me. God bless you.
So I was there in March, and everything he said is absolutely true, no doubt. So if you would all extend your hands, I'd like to pray for Del Rey Ministries, Kim and his family, and the trip. So, Father God, we thank you. We come before you and thank you with all our hearts, Father, that what you've given us and just the great joy that we are able and capable to go do the work for you, Father, to help spread your word and continue to spread your word and bring others to your word and help them go through baptisms and help them go through life, Father. We thank you so much for Delray Ministries and the work that they do. They multiply and multiply your word thousands of times, Father. And we just continue to act and continue to protect and provide for them. Father, we thank you for everything you've given us in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. Welcome. So glad that you're here and excited for part three of our series Under Pressure. Today we'll be talking about tested and ready. And are you ready for some Sunday night football tonight? We're going to be testing a new quarterback, I hear. That's exciting. I was kind of holding out hope. The Pirates season ended a few months ago. But I was kind of holding out hope, for some teams that I was rooting for, and I was I root against the Yankees. Okay, anybody with me? Like anybody who's playing the Yankees. So I was like, hey, we got to root for Cleveland, which was hard, but I was like, hey, I'm gonna do it. Yeah, we've got one Cleveland fan. He's like, come on. So I was rooting for him last week, and I don't know if anybody's like me and you, you like yell at the TV because you think somebody might be listening. And I was watching. I was rooting for Cleveland. And they made two mistakes that were pretty critical, and so I yelled, just raised my voice a little bit in the living room, and I just said, Cleveland, this is why you're always Cleveland. And I turned the channel, and my wife said, that wasn't very nice. I said, well, it's true. And then I give her a bunch of history of the Cleveland Indians, Guardians. And but I get passionate about sports and being a fan, and one of the things I really get passionate about is college basketball. That's about to start. That's the thing that probably I enjoy more than anything, especially March Madness. Growing up in Kansas, going to lots of Kansas basketball games, so I'm always rooting for them. But also, I usually pick a team if they don't make it to the Final Four and root for them. And I was thinking back to just reflecting recently about a couple years. 2018 and 2019. How many love watching the upsets, the underdogs win, right? Exciting stuff, but it's also heartbreaking for the team that was favored. And one of those teams was a team called the Virginia Cavaliers in 2018. They were the number one overall seed. They were expected to kind of go a long way, and they were the recipient of like the biggest upset probably ever. And that a little team, UMBC from Maryland, little tiny school, never won anything, actually upset them. And the player on the team was named Kyle Guy, who was just a highly recruited player and person of faith, a follower of Jesus. And he took it really, really, really hard. And here's a picture from the aftermath of that game. On the one side is the team that was celebrating, the Retrievers of UMBC. And this was Kyle Guy there in the middle. He took it so hard. And then a couple weeks later, he did something that nobody had ever really done, a player after this. And he had written a letter to himself before the tournament and then after the tournament. And he shared those letters on social media about what he was going through. And I want to just share an excerpt from what Kyle went through. And one of the things he shared, you can find this online. And but he said, everything you are is because of, this is to himself, mind you, of your fiance and your small circle of family and friends. Don't ever take them for granted. You're going to need them. This was before the upset. This was the letter before it. Not everyone knows, but you've been taking medication for your anxiety attacks all season. You've kept it a secret because you didn't want to be viewed as weak. You were worried people might think you aren't built for this. But now you need to realize that even if they do think that, that's fine. They can think that. They weren't with you when you bursted into tears in the middle of practice and you didn't understand why. When your fiance helped calm you down night after night when the pressure seemed to consume you. You couldn't smile through the latter half of the season because of anxiety and pressure was eating at you, but you kept pushing. Next slide there. Remember why you chose to play with the best team you've ever played for, full of the greatest people you ever encountered. They have your back, your family has your back, and you are a child of God. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Psalm 23:4. You have always been a believer that pressure is just a figment of your imagination, as is fear. It only becomes real if you let it. If you begin to think too much about the past or the future or what people think, it can become so very real. He just poured all this stuff out online to let fans know that he was going through such great pressure, being tested emotionally, mentally. And you fast forward, that was 2018, you fast forward to 2019, and they were in the Final Four. They had made it past a couple big games, exciting games. I remember watching this game, and they were down, I think it was 4 points with about 9 seconds left, and he hit a three-pointer, and then they fouled. The other team, Auburn, they were playing, hit one free throw, drove the ball down, and with 1.5 seconds, they threw him the ball. He went up for a three-pointer and was fouled. And so with 0.6 seconds left, we'll see a picture, he found himself with 3 free throws down by 2. And he sunk all 3. And they won that game. And then 2 nights later, this was the scene. They won the whole thing. And the interesting thing, the picture before, one of the players from the other team was going to say, hey, he's going to choke, right? The pressure's going to get to him. And yet, it didn't. Here, and I've reflected back and just knowing a little bit about his story, how that 2018 experience, he was tested. He was tested, and so was the coach who just retired, Tony Bennett, is a passionate follower of Jesus. He was tested too, made many testimonies of God's faithfulness through the entire thing. You know, we are tested for a purpose. God tests us so that we'll be ready for what he has planned for us, and that's what he had experienced. We all want to experience God's plans for our life. We want to see good things. We want to see influence. We want to see healthy things in our life. We want to produce fruit. And that goes back to what Jesus said, I am the vine and you are the branches. And he wants to produce good things in our life. But to do that, we have to be tested. We have to be tested. It's a hard thing. We have to endure the pressure of testing so that we'll be ready when that time comes to produce good things, to be a witness. So what we're going to look at today is a very interesting, unique scripture. This is Jesus being tested. And just to preface it a little bit here, John, last week, if you missed it, I encourage you to watch the message, and I talked about that John the Baptist and God the Father had just announced Jesus, okay? So John the Baptist went through and said, hey, the Messiah is coming, and then he shows up, and he's like, look, he's there, and then baptizes him. There's a moment God in heaven speaks, this is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased. So there's an announcement. Next week is baptism. Why should you get baptized? If you've had a heart change, God has changed your life and your heart. On the other side, one of the first things to do in scripture is to announce it. to go public with it. We have a baptism orientation between services. Love for you to come back to the cafe if you want to know more. Excited to share that. So now Jesus, after this announcement, before ministry must be tested. So let's look at it. In the NIV translation, verses 1 through 11, it says this. And Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. After fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. The tempter came to him and said, "If you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread." Jesus answered, "It is written, 'Man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God.'" Then the devil took him to the holy city and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. "If you are the Son of God," he said, "throw yourself down, for it is written, 'He will command his angels concerning you, and they will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone.'" Jesus answered him, "It is also written, 'Do not put the Lord your God to the test.'" Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain, showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. "All this I will give you," he said, "if you will bow down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away from me, Satan, for it is written, 'Worship the Lord your God and serve him only.'" Then the devil left him, and the angels came and attended to him. What a scene, what a powerful scene. Very unique but necessary time of testing for Jesus. But going back to this first verse, then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. First question, why? Right? You see this, we read this, why did the Spirit lead Jesus into this testing? In the NIV, in different translations, you'll see little headings, and I think that's an appropriate one in the NIV over this scripture. It says, Jesus being tested. Now, Jesus is tempted, but that's part of his testing. Okay, so sometimes being tempted and overcoming temptation is part of a testing period. But testing includes a lot of things. In fact, at this point, he's vulnerable. And this is something important. We all have points of being vulnerable, where we are more vulnerable than others. Being tired. In this case, he is tired, he is hungry, and he is by himself. Folks, it is in those times where the enemy often comes to tempt us. When you are by yourself, okay, you're hungry, maybe physically, but you also might be hungry for other things, all right, and tired. This is the time when the enemy comes to tempt us and test us. So here's to answer this question. There are four answers to why did the Spirit lead Jesus into this testing. The first two are specific to Jesus. The other two are actually for us. The first is this, to prove Jesus' identity as God's Son. You see, it said the devil, if you look at everything he's actually saying, "If you are the Son of God." That is, he's questioning his identity, all right? And the enemy wants to do the same thing to you if you are a follower of Jesus, if you really believe. That is at the heart of temptation for you. Number two, to prepare Jesus for public ministry. All right, so there's been a big announcement, but Jesus doesn't go run out and then start teaching. No, he endures a time of fasting, of solitude, and here now testing to prepare you for the ministry. And mind you, if you're a follower of Jesus, he has called you. He has called you. There is a calling on your life. For some of you, that calling, you're saying, I can't be up on a stage. That's okay. Not everybody's called to be on a stage. In fact, important work. We heard about important work in the Dominican Republic. There's missions. There's behind the scenes. There's things that people are doing and serving and contributing. And you find that, and listen, before you step into that, as you step into that, sometimes we need testing to prepare us for that. Number three, to comfort us in our times of temptation. This is more for us in Hebrews chapter 2, verse 18. You can look at that scripture later, but we are told Jesus has experienced the temptations and the feelings that we have. We have a high priest who knows what it feels like. Jesus is our high priest who walked through all the emotions you walked through, experienced it all. When I was in student ministry, I remember doing a series called Been There, Felt That. Jesus has been there, felt that. Whatever you're going through right now, whatever emotions that are deep in your heart, whether it's sorrow, depression, rejection, betrayal, list them out. I guarantee you, Jesus has been there and felt that. So he is able to comfort us in our times of temptation. And the last thing is to point to the power of Scripture. In cartoons, I don't know, I'm sure in movies too, there was that moment of temptation in a cartoon, and there were two things on the shoulder, right? The devil and an angel going back and forth, right? That doesn't happen, by the way, in real life. I don't think if you're actually seeing that, I don't know if you had something too much in your coffee or what, but that's not really what's happening. In fact, we're not to look for some angel on our shoulder. What we should be doing is looking to Scripture. If you're in that moment of temptation, this is Jesus on three pointed temptations turning to Scripture and rebuking the devil. Now, most of us are not fond of tests, okay? Very rarely do I meet someone and say, yeah, I'm so excited I have a test this weekend, right? It's like we all dread that, or we're like, we don't like the pressure. But we can all appreciate people being tested. I'll illustrate this a little bit. Let's see, it was 21 years ago. I had an injury, a work injury, and I had to have back surgery. And pretty serious. I had a friend who was a chiropractor that was not in favor of me getting surgery, but I was in so much pain. I was like, listen, I have to do this. He's like, man, I remember him saying, you know, there's been people that have died, you know, on the table from this stuff. And I'm like, man, thanks for sharing with that with me. It's so encouraging. So I remember going up, and this was in St. Louis, Missouri, and my wife and I, and we sat down with the surgeon, and he talked us through the whole thing, and he was like, what concerns do you have? And I was like, well, you know, I want to make sure. I was like, how many, you know, tell me about your experience here, because I have a little hesitation, you know. And he said, well, he said, I just recently, this last year, operated on my partner, and he was out playing golf last week. I was like, okay, that's good. He said, also, I've done over 1,000 of these surgeries. I was like, okay, right? I wanted to hear that. I didn't want to hear him say, I stayed at a Holiday Inn Express last night. You know those commercials, right? I don't know. I don't know how to do this, but I did, you know, stay in a Holiday Inn Express last night. No, he said 1,000 times I've done this surgery. I was like, okay, I think I'm in good hands. Sounds like you've been tested and you're ready. All of us want to know that. Whether it's in the medical profession, you go to a dentist, you want to see things up on the wall, right? Not something they just printed off, you know, last night. You know, that would be scary, okay? For us, we need spiritual testing. God knows this. He wants to strengthen our spiritual character. Why do we need this? First, because you are called to follow in His steps. You are called to follow in Jesus' steps. Our mission here is to help people find and follow who? Jesus. Who? Jesus. Okay, so we are called to follow Jesus in His steps. This is about your purpose. Your purpose in life, why you were created. This is so important for us to understand. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 21, it says, to this you were called because Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example so that you should follow in His steps. That's a hard act to follow, Jesus. How in the world can we do this? Well, we need to walk through the stuff He walked through. If Jesus was tested, so must we. be tested. It all looks different for us. God knows what we can handle. He's not going to give you more than what you can handle or endure. Even though there are times in your testing, be like, okay, God, this is too much. Right? We've all been there. Whoa, this is enough. This is too much. But listen, I can tell you from experience and many times where I've said that very thing and knowing on the other side of it, I knew God had brought me to that place like a refiner's fire, under pressure, knowing it would make me stronger. And He knows what you need to walk through. So that you, because here's the reality, in those hard times, folks, listen, in the hardest times, what are you doing? You are desperately calling out to Him. You are at a point where you're like, there is no other way I can do this without Him. I can't do this without Him. I need Him. So your purpose, okay, we are called to His to follow in His steps. That's the first reason. The second thing is because you are gifted for good plans. This is about your identity. Your identity. What is that? For this is one of my favorite scriptures, Ephesians 2:10. I love this. For we are God's masterpiece. Masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so that we can do the good things He planned for us long ago. Turn to your neighbor and say, He's got good things. Come on, tell him. Tell him like you mean it. All right? Good things. This, I don't usually go into like the biblical languages thing, but this is really valuable. For the New Testament was written in Greek, and that word for masterpiece is poema. Anyone want to guess where we got what that word is in our language now? Poem. Poem. You are a masterpiece. God has written something beautiful in your DNA, your spiritual DNA. You are a work of art, each and every one of you, unique, with a beautiful purpose. And the story of your life and purpose and calling is something that needs to be told because you will testify to the good things of God. We must be tested because you are gifted for good plans. And for those good plans to come to fruition, you must have more trust. You must lean in even more, have a deep connection with God so they can see those good things. The third reason is because greater things are possible. Greater things are possible. This is about your faith. John 14:12, another one of my favorites. Very truly I tell you, whoever believes in me will do the works I have been doing, and they will do even greater things because I am going to the Father. All right, so he's got good plans, and now Jesus is talking about greater things. Greater things. When I think about this verse, when I first read this, and actually this was my verse of the year that I prayed through this was 2019. I prayed greater things. God, I want to know what these greater things are. If you're going to do greater things, you want to do greater things, he was saying to his disciples, you're going to see bigger things than what you see me doing. And you're going to be a part of that. And you wondered, well, did that happen? It's called the book of Acts. And the same God, the same Holy Spirit that empowered the disciples to see this happen, he's in you. If you are a follower of Jesus, he wants to empower you for greater things. When you see this scripture, this is your reaction should be this. The greater things, this. Right? Right? Wait, Jesus, the Son of God, who rose people from the dead, who also rose on the third day, who did miracle after miracle, said, greater things for you. That's what you should be thinking. What? really? You have greater things? Here's the reality, though. Some of you, if you're honest, do you really believe that? Here's a better question. Does your life and how you're living life and how you think about yourself, how you think about your journey of following Jesus, does it reflect this reality that he has good plans and greater things? Do you really believe it? Or will you settle? And here's how we settle. This is the temptation. Settle for the American dream, not God's dream. That's the temptation. And listen, it's not just America. It's everywhere. There's different things. But here, in Western Christianity, in America, the temptation is, let me just settle for what everybody else says I should be straining for and working for and trying for. And it's like this emptiness. We keep throwing stuff into this hole and thinking, man, it'll fill up and I'll feel good. And yet we always get to that place where, like, I still feel empty. Because God is saying, I actually have greater things, which is why I need to test you. You know, before your calling, before the good plans, and before the greater things, we all need to be tested. Thinking about this, reflecting back on a couple things. First of all, I was watching an interview with Dallas Jenkins, who created The Chosen. Who's watched The Chosen before? You like, enjoy that? Great, great series. But I heard a bit about his story that I hadn't heard. This last week, I was watching an interview. He was being interviewed at a church. And he said, they asked him, so why did you create this? Why'd you create this series that's now watched by millions around the world? How did this come to be? What was this big moment? And here's what he said. He said, in 2017, I directed a movie that was the biggest failure of my life. I directed this thing. It was a total flop. Critics tore it to shreds. And on the other side of it, this is what he said. He said, after that, I just said, okay, God, I can't do this. What do you want me to do? He had to go through this huge failure so that he could then say, all right, God, you show me. You show me what you want. In my own life, my wife and I, we set out for Omaha, Nebraska in 2004 with a big dream. I had a dream. We had a dream for planning this church. And I remember it was part of my last master's degree project. And I had this big, thick notebook of all the research and all the dreams. And I remember saying, man, we're going to have a church of 500 to 600 people, and we're going to plant other churches. And I remember just describing all these dreams. Can I tell you, after 11 years, and as I look back, and I had, I got to a place where I almost burned out. And at our height, I think our average was like 80 or 90 people. And we merged with another church at the end of that. And looking back, though, there's so many good things that God did in that. If I'm being honest with you right now, do you want me to be? I should, probably. But I've thought about this many times. I was not ready for anything more than that. God knew I needed to be tested. I need to be tested. I need to be tested with a lot of disappointment, a lot of things, a lot of my ideas that didn't work. I needed to be tested with some hard things. And I know the tests aren't finished. But as I look back, there are many good things, but I just know I needed to be tested. And that was part of that, that I wasn't ready for big success then. And maybe you're in that place right now where you're hoping and dreaming for more or bigger or they're good dreams. You're like, why can't this thing get going? Well, you might be in the middle of a test. Can you handle what you've been given? Can you handle just a little bit of success? Can you handle some failure? So, three tests, though. we must all take. Three tests that Jesus took. With all this in mind, I want to just review these. First, we need a test of provision. All right? Jesus was first asked, if you're the Son of God, I'll tell these stones to become, tell these stones to become bread. Just so you know, he's very hungry. It's been 40 days without food. That's a serious fasting. And Jesus would later feed 5,000 people, right? That was a pretty big miracle. He could feed one. Retrospectively, we know this wasn't a hard thing, but his power was not about provision for himself. And he knew this. And in this moment, the devil is saying, provide for you. For us, we have the same temptation. We are tempted to do for you. In times of crisis, we get to this place where we're saying, well, God hasn't provided, hasn't taken care of this. I look at my bank account. I look at what's going on in my work. I look at what's going on in my physical world and this struggle. And man, I prayed just a little bit and nothing's happened. So now I think I just need to take matters into my own hands. I got to figure this thing out. I got to do this on my own. God, I know I need to trust you. But I think I'm going to figure this out on my own. That's the temptation. And it's usually in the midst of, and just as I was praying through this last night, there's just this sense for somebody, great fear and anxiety of what's next. What's the next thing that could even happen? You have already experienced maybe heartache. You've maybe experienced something that was unexpected, and you're thinking, I don't know if I can take something else, so I need to take things into my own hands. Whatever that is, this test is like, okay, God is saying, will you just trust me a little bit more for the good plans and the greater things? Because it's in these seasons we are refined. He wants to do this in us. So we are tempted to do it all ourselves, but we should trust him. Number two, a test of relationship. Test of relationship. If you are the Son of God, he said, throw yourself down. This is an emotional moment, all right? The enemy wants to attack our emotions. If your father really loves you, he will save you. That's what he's saying. Jesus, if your father really loves you, you're the Son of God, if you just jump off here, he'll take care of you. Craig Keener, one of my favorite biblical scholars, says, the devil wants Jesus to presume upon his relationship with God to act as if God is there to serve his son. We are tempted the same way. Tempted to think, God, you are here to serve me and do what I want. This feeling and this relational thing, we are tempted emotionally to presume upon our relationship with God, to say, God, my will is this, and this is what I want. Would you please do it in my timing? And God in heaven is saying, I have a bigger plan, and it's actually better than yours. That's what I always have to remind myself. Sometimes I'm like, hey, God, would you just tell me what you're doing? And then I realize, well, if he tells me everything, I'll probably just mess it up. So never mind. Don't tell me. It's better. I'm just going to trust you. How is this playing out in your life? How is this playing out in your life? This relational this connection that he wants you to have is in the Lord's Prayer. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Not in my heart, not by my will, not my dreams. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. I want that more than anything. even though it might be disappointing at times. I want that. And when you do that, this relationship between us as a child of God and our Heavenly Father gets stronger and stronger because we trust Him and we say, God, I love you even though I don't understand. God, I love you even though this hurts. God, I love you. It's a test of relationship. The last thing is, this is a hard one, a test of control. All this I will give you, the enemy, the devil said, if you will bow down and worship me. You know, there's an interesting dynamic here. I think in control, maybe you're here and you like to control things, right? All right? All of us, I think, struggle with this in certain ways, and maybe you would be the first to say I'm a little bit of a control freak. I think all of us have that in us about certain things, okay? Like, I gotta figure this out, and I gotta take care of this. I gotta fix this. That's a piece of it. But there's another piece, and I think sometimes it's when we are hurt, when we are offended, one of the things we like to do is take control of the situation and take the control over other people in our lives. Sometimes that is offense, bitterness. Sometimes this is, I am going to try to control their emotions by not talking to them and treating them different and so on and so forth. That kind of control. And all the while, when you think you have control, what you don't realize is you're actually bowing down to the enemy and what he wants, which is to create more chaos and more pain and more hurt and more unforgiveness. And yet, God is saying, I sent you my son to die for your sins, to wash you clean, and to forgive all that you have done. Now, can you not do that for others? That's scriptural. Book of Colossians. So, this control, maybe you're in this test. Things have not gone your way. You've been hurt by someone. And our response is sometimes, I'm going to take control of this. I'm going to take the narrative here. I'm going to control the narrative, and I'm going to control the outcomes. And folks, I know for some of you right now, you're saying, Pastor Jay, you have no idea how much I was hurt. You're right, I don't. But God does. And guess what? Whatever you're feeling, Jesus felt it too. And he knows how you feel. And the test is, will you let him know how you feel and trust him? Trust him. Trust him to lead you through reconciliation. I love the scripture in Philippians chapter 2. Every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. This, you see, Jesus was given total control after the cross, sitting at the right hand of the Father. Even though the devil wanted him to take control in that moment, he said, no, I know what God has planned. I'll trust you. You know, as we conclude, the big question is, some of you are in a test right now. One of these things is kind of, you know, pinging your radar. It's kind of like, yep, I'm in this. It's even bigger than what you're describing. I'm in this test. I'm being tempted. And maybe you feel like, hey, I failed. And let me remind you, you are under grace, God's grace. There's nothing, no mess he can't clean up and no situation he can't redeem. I was reading through a devotional by Rick Warren. And it had me, because I had this couple questions. First, how do you respond if you're in this season? This is one of the things that I took from my devotion. It says, life is not fair. You will have problems, difficulties, and hurts that will make you either better or bitter. You will either grow up or give up. You will either become who God wants you to be, or your heart will become hard. You have to decide how you are going to respond to the tough times in your life. That's the piece for us. God has given you free will so that you can respond with obedience and trust and draw closer and run to Him, or take control take control and try to do things your own way, how are you responding to the test in your life right now? Right now, I'd invite you, I would plead with you to cling to the Father. Cling to Him. Trust Him a little bit more. I know it's hard. The second thing is, who are you taking the test with? When I was thinking about this, about the testing idea, I kept thinking of the number two pencil, which I couldn't find one in my house, so I guess I'm done taking tests, right? You have the number two, take out your number two pencil, the Scantron, right? And you are always solo. When you take a test in school, it's like you're on your own. You're on your own. Guess what? In the journey of following Jesus, you should never be alone. You should never be alone. So testing, taking this test, listen, with Jesus, because of Jesus, He sent His Holy Spirit so that you would not be alone, so that you would have a counselor, so that you would be empowered, so that He would whisper through Scripture, through a still small voice, and through people around you, the community. You see, God's Spirit, God's Scripture, and God's community is here for you. Don't do it alone. Whether it's taking out a card today on your info card and saying, I need someone to pray for me. Whether it's coming and talking to myself, Pastor Josh, Pastor Trey, Pastor Mike, anybody here that can just pray with you. Go to your connect group and say, please, I need someone to pray with me and talk with me. Sign up to do a follow coaching. We've figured out as many ways possible for you to connect with other people so you don't go it alone. That's our prayer for you. In this moment, will you bow your heads with me just to take a moment and give you a chance to respond? First, if you're here today and just in that moment, if you feel like maybe, just maybe, you failed, you're struggling with that, like you failed someone, you failed God, you've went through this testing recently, and you are in this brokenness of feeling that way, and God in heaven wants you to know, you are no failure. You are a masterpiece. But you need to be encouraged right now by the Holy Spirit, by this community, to know you are a child of God and He loves you just the same. Just slip up your hand and say, that's me. I just need to know that. Yes, lots of hands. God loves you. He cares for you. He adores you. He does not think less of you. And so right now, Lord, I pray that you would speak life over every person who's in that season right now. The enemy is lying to them, but they are a child of God, the one true King. Let them know it in every way possible. And if you're here today and you are being tested, tempted, struggling, you're in it right now, and you say, Pastor Jay, I need supernatural strength right now to get through this. Help me. Just slip up your hand. Say, that's me. Just slip up your hand real high. Say, I'm in it right now. Lord, in the name of Jesus, those who are in a test, in a season, Lord, I pray that you would help them to endure. It is hard to find joy, but they would find joy in their relationship with you. Pull them close, oh God, during this season. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Will you stand and let's worship together during this time? If you need prayer, you can come. I'll be up here at the front or after the service. Come and pray. Want to be able to minister to you.
Shepherd, and He is everything I need. So I will not worry, I will not fear the enemy. He said that He loves me, He said that He's with me, even though I walk through the valley of shadow and death, and still I know He has good plans. He has good plans for me. So I will take heart in deserts and gardens. He has good plans. He has good plans for me. I know my Father, I know my Father has good plans. The Lord is my Savior, so why should I doubt my victory? Why would I question the rod and staff that comforts me? He quiets the waters, He quiets the storm inside of me. What could be better than walking with Him when I believe? He has good plans. He has good plans for me. So I will take heart in deserts and deserts and gardens. He has good plans.
I can't tell you how many times, knowing that God has good plans for me, has gotten me through rough times in life, has kept my eyes focused on Him in good times in life. I honestly don't know where I would be without Him, but it wouldn't be good. And so if you're in here this morning, and you heard Pastor Jay's message, you hear us singing these songs, and something's happening in your heart. You have not accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, but something's going on and you don't know quite how to describe it. I would encourage you to take that step of faith, to trust God, to trust that He has good plans for you, and to follow Him with the rest of your life. And if you choose to take that step, we have resources for you right here at the front. Two books called He Did This Just For You and First Steps, which help you to understand why Jesus is so important for us and what are the first steps that we can take as we begin to follow Him. And the third book that we have for you to take is the most important one, in my opinion, and that is the Bible. If you do not have a physical Bible at home, please come up here and take one of these. And all of these are available to you for free. And not only do we have physical written resources, we have ourselves. Pastor Jay at the end of his message said that we will be up here for prayer. We're not just here for prayer. We are here to walk through life with you. And so if you're going through something, you need to talk through something, you didn't take the opportunity during this last worship song to come up to us and pray with us, your opportunity is not gone. Reach out to us throughout the week. Talk to us after service. Whenever, we are here for you. You do not have to do this alone. And before we let you go this morning, just want to celebrate something. You'll see our giving ways to give up on the screen, but I want to celebrate you and your generosity. So we refer to Operation October in the month of October as the time that we take to gather resources and give it to other people. Pastor Jay said that we are supposed to be following in the footsteps of Jesus. Well, Jesus cared about people who were in need. And so we, as His followers, have the opportunity to extend need to people who need it. And so for this month, we have collected $1,400 and 112 bags of clothing and blankets to give to those who are in need. And that is from all of you. So go ahead and give yourselves a round of applause. That is incredible. And we're not done yet. We have still got this Sunday and next Sunday that we are still collecting items for Operation October. So your generosity has already exceeded expectations, and we still have time for you to give even more if you feel so led to. So thank you so much for your generosity. You are an incredible church. I love being able to serve and give alongside of you. So as we always say, we're going to leave from here today, but we hope that you don't just leave. We want you to go with God and go find the one. Have a great day, church.